Positioning controls give us nearly unlimited flexibility when creating modern layouts for the web. There are six here that we'll cover: static, relative, including z-index, absolute, fixed, sticky, and floats. And we'll use practical examples we can apply to our designs. And with any leftover time, we'll read together from the novelization of Star Trek Insurrection. Up first is static. And now we'll cover static positioning. Static is just the default. When you drag something in, whenever you add a thing anywhere in your project, it's static. Things are positioned using the box model. That is, as we know, things stack on top of each other or next to each other based on what kind of element it is and what its display setting is in layouts. And for most designers, for most basic designs, statically positioned elements, the default, that's okay. But what happens when we want to change things? Let's talk about our first non-static position, and that's relative. A relatively positioned element is just like a static element, but you can move it around from its default place. And when you do, notice the other content on the page, it doesn't affect the document flow. It's like there's a seat warmer in its place. Its spot in the document is preserved. That's what it means when we say this element is relative to itself. You're positioning it relative to its static, its default position. Of course, you can click in and position using presets, or you can type in a value in pixels, percentages, VW. We cover a lot of these units in size, so check that out if you haven't already. But relative goes further, because notice how we've unlocked a ton of control here. And whether or not you're using relative to move things, you can also set z-index. And it's called z-index because it controls stacking in front of or behind what someone sees on the screen. That's our z-axis. And two important things to consider here. Z-index does control stacking, but it doesn't control actual movement along the z-axis. And the second thing is, z-index is a great conversation starter at parties. So if we have a collage of photos, we just move these around, you can see the position on each of them has been manually changed using relative positioning. And by default, sibling elements, things that appear on the same level under other things in the navigator, things that come after others stack on top. But if we want one of them to stack on top of the others, we'll just go in. Again, we've already set these to relative, and we'll change the Z index to 1. Now it stacks on top. And if we want this one on top of that, we set it to 2. Let's select the left one and set the Z index to 2. What's going to happen? Well, like we learned in AP calculus, 2 is greater than 1. So of course, it'll stack above. Same thing with this one. The higher the number, the higher it stacks. Also, if you have two elements, both set to static, just default positioning, the moment you set something to not static, any of these others here, the selected element will stack on top of static elements. You want the other one to stack on top of that, you know what to do. Set it to relative, and now we can stack it on top. But here's the catch with z-index. It's not global. If we have two elements, each of these elements has children, z-index will control the stacking for these parent elements. But if element A has a higher z-index than element B, the children of element B will never overlap any part of element A, even if the z-index is 3 trillion. But that's relative positioning. Let's unlock even more options with absolute positioning. And here's our first big difference. Absolutely positioned elements are no longer part of the document flow. They don't leave a seat warmer, and they only push off what you tell them to push off of. And here's how we'll show that. Let's set the top value here to 0, and let's set the left value here to 0. Notice how the absolutely positioned element is now placed way on the top left of the body element. But here's where we have all sorts of control. We can choose from these presets to position something, again, relative to the body, but we can also constrain all of this. In our navigator, we can see our body has a section in it, well, several sections, and a footer and a small image of Daniel Craig. What we just demonstrated, though, is that absolutely positioned elements will position themselves around the body element. But all we have to do, if we want our element to be positioned around our section, is set the section to relative. That's because absolute positioning looks up the element hierarchy. It looks for the first thing it finds that's not set to static, and it positions itself around that. But while the concept makes sense, this isn't really practical here. That's because absolute positioning is more often used by designers when we don't want whatever item we're positioning to mess with the rest of the document flow. So how can we tie this together with a practical user interface? Here's a div block inside an interface. This is just a div block, the whole window here is sort of functioning as a pop-up modal. And the div block inside, the one housing our three circles, is positioned by default using static positioning. And first, let's demonstrate that as we move this throughout the modal, throughout this window, it's pushing other stuff around. That's static behavior. But what if we position it absolutely? Well, it's no longer pushing things around, and if we set it to 0 pixels from the top, and for this, 0 pixels from the right, now it's on the top right corner of the body. It's positioned around our whole page now. But as we know, we can do one thing to bring it back to the window, back to the sort of pop-up modal itself. We could set the div block, the modal here, to relative positioning. And if we decide we want our controls on the left, more of a Mac OS alignment, with our div block of circles selected, we can just set it to 0 pixels from the left. And this is really practical. We can use absolute positioning on things like pop-up modals, anytime we want something to show up where it's positioned around a parent element. But just like that, we built an entire operating system, except no, we didn't. And we'll come back to absolute positioning in a few moments, but for now, let's cover fixed positioning. If absolutely positioned elements are perfect for positioning things around other elements, all the way up to the body element, fixed positioning is even one level higher. And that's because elements set to fixed position now respect the viewport itself. Of course, the viewport is the part of the browser that houses whatever's currently visible. If you position something using fixed, two things happen. First, just like absolute positioning, our fixed image here is no longer part of the document flow. We can see the text and everything else moved up. But two, we can now position it. And when we do, it's now fixed to the bottom right of the viewport. This is going to stay on the bottom right of the viewport, even as you scroll through a longer document, like the collected works of Emily Dickinson. Fixed positioning is helpful if you're building something like a banner, which you want to be visible as someone scrolls down the page. Just set it to fixed, position it however you want. In this case, it's 0 pixels from the left and right, and 0 pixels from the bottom. And now, as we scroll down, it remains in the same spot. Again, it's positioned around the viewport, not any specific element on the page. Another really common use for fixed positioning is a pop-up modal, which we'll demonstrate now by using a photo of Academy Award winner Meryl Streep. Let's add a div block. It doesn't matter that much where we put it. We can put it right inside the body. But here's the important thing. We'll set this div block to fixed positioning. And we can use our preset here to set it to 0 on all sides. It'll take up the full viewport. And we can set the background image. We can add a background image and choose an image of Meryl Streep. And the reason we're doing this is because once we configure our background image, we can demonstrate that no matter how far down the page we scroll, Meryl Streep is always there. And the only difference with a pop-up modal is that usually it's not a picture of Meryl Streep, and it's more often a background color that helps draw some contrast, something that implies a change. A common one here is a background color that's darker, sometimes with a lower opacity. And what it's doing is this. Not only is the div block, which is really the start of our pop-up modal, not only is it fixed to all sides of our viewport, but it's not moving as we scroll. That's the difference between absolute and fixed positioning. Both of them remove an object from the document flow, but an element set to fixed positioning always stays fixed to the viewport. Here's why that matters. If we're building a pop-up modal, we'll probably want another div block right in the center. So since our dark lower opacity background is fixed, that means children of that background are also fixed. So if we size this new div block, just for this example, let's set it to a 400 pixel width and a 200 pixel height. And just so we could see what's going on, if we set our background color to something, when we scroll, because our new lighter color div block is inside the fixed, darker, lower opacity thing, the new div block doesn't move either. Fixed elements, in fact, all types of positioning, affect an element and its children. So that means the children can be styled however you want. For instance, let's select our fixed element, that darker background, and we'll set it to flexbox, making sure its child elements align and justify to the center. When we scroll, we have this darker background that's fixed, and its children elements also stay fixed with our background. Now, we have full teaching available on this over on Webflow University, so if you want to dig deeper into creating a pop-up modal, check that out if you haven't done so already. But fixed positioning is a very effective tool. In fact, Bloomberg said it best in their prescient 2008 write-up on web design. They said, "We can't get to it because they're using a pop-up modal." Now, we're not done with fixed. We'll come back to it in a second for a comparison, but for now, let's talk sticky positioning. And we're going to show two practical examples, a sticky navbar, navigation that stays on the top of the viewport as you scroll, and a sticky sidebar that stays in the same position, but respects the boundaries of the section it's inside. First one is the navbar, and it's fairly straightforward. Here's a navbar, and by default, its position is set to static. Let's first set it to fixed, so we can see what that does. And notice what happened there, because we'll cover that change in a second. But first, let's select our top preset so everything's positioned correctly. And now we'll toggle back and forth between static and fixed. And here's what's happening. We know the moment we make something fixed, it's no longer behaving like a static element. The section underneath is now tucking behind the navbar. And as we scroll, the navbar is fixed to the viewport. But with sticky, let's just change the position to sticky. And to make sure we're not inheriting any of those top values we just set from our fixed example, let's clear all that out. But now that it's sticky, notice how even as we scroll, it's not very sticky. That's because the key to sticky positioning is telling it how far you can scroll before it sticks. Let's set our top value to 0. And that means now it'll stick right at the top. So as we scroll, it's stuck to the top of the viewport. But the distinction here is if we switch between static and sticky, we can see that unlike fixed positioning, sticky behaves just like a static element. Nothing's tucking behind anything else because sticky elements still take up space. But here's another thing we can do. Here's a sidebar inside a section. If we look in the navigator, we can see the section is a parent of the sidebar, but this works for almost any element. And without doing anything, if we scroll down the page, the sidebar does whatever things normally do when they scroll down a page. Nothing special yet. With the sidebar selected, let's go down and set our position to sticky. And when we do, if we scroll now, the sidebar again does whatever things normally do when they scroll down a page. Remember, we have to define under what circumstances the element sticks. So let's set the top value to 0. That means when we're scrolling, we can see here, the sidebar scrolls normally until it hits 0 pixels from the top of the viewport. Then it sticks. But check this out. This is where the sidebar in a section example is more interesting. When it reaches the end, when we get to the end of the sidebar's parent element, the section, it starts scrolling normally again, anchored to the bottom of the section as we scroll. That's because elements positioned using sticky will usually stick only while their parent element is in view. And when the sidebar hits the bottom of its parent, it begins scrolling normally. We can also choose a higher value here. Maybe instead of 0, we have a higher value in pixels. That means we can see this as we scroll, that the element now begins sticking when it hits that number, that many pixels from the top of the viewport. That's sticky positioning. Finally, we have floats and clears, and these have a lot of historical baggage on the web. A lot of people used to use floats and clears for positioning all sorts of things, but since Flexbox and Grid became more mainstream, there are far less infuriating ways to build common layouts. So, does that mean floats and clears are obsolete? Not at all. In fact, they're still highly practical for a number of applications. And to demonstrate this, we have some headings, some paragraphs, and an image. If we want the image to float to the left of all this text, we just float it to the left. Notice how all the paragraphs, the heading, they're all sort of wrapping around the image. We can even add margin on the image, margin on the right and margin on the bottom, so there's some breathing room. And notice how the top heading isn't affected. That's because floats work like this. They'll only make other elements wrap around if those elements are after the thing that's floating. And we can see the document order. We can check the order of elements in the navigator. In fact, if we want the top heading to wrap, we just move it below the image. And just like that, the top heading is wrapping too. If we want it back on the top, back on the top. And what if we want things to float right? Same deal here. We select the image and float it to the right. Of course, now we'll probably want to remove the right margin and add some more to the left side. And if floats let us float things where paragraphs, if floats make other stuff like text or anything in line wrap around a floated element, then clears will make those things clear out of the way and start after the floated element. Now, that was a terrible sentence. Instead, let's demonstrate by selecting one of these text elements, the heading, which right now is wrapping around the floated image. If we clear it, if we choose clear both, it's cleared. It got out of the way. Now, clear left, clear right, do these things matter? No, but yes, they do. In a lot of circumstances, clear both is a quick way to clear something from any floated element, but what if we have something like this? An image floating on the left and an image floating right. Clear left, that'll clear things floating left. Clear right, that'll clear things floating right. So, floats can be applied to elements, most commonly an image element, to get things like text or inline objects to wrap around that element. Clears are applied to the elements we want cleared from whatever thing is floating. Floats, they're easier to demonstrate than they are to talk about, but they're an extremely useful tool in our design and development toolbox. But that's it, a lot to review here, and we'll do it pretty quickly. And if that was too quick, let's review at a different pace. We covered statically positioned elements, which are the default way elements position themselves. We covered relative positioning, which lets you position something relative to its original spot, but it doesn't mess with other stuff on the page. We covered absolute positioning, which pulls something out from the document flow and lets you position that something around other elements. We covered fixed positioning, which fixes an element to the viewport itself. We covered sticky positioning, which lets us make something stick to the viewport as soon as it's however far from the top of the viewport you specifically specify. We sat collectively befuddled at the use of specifically specify, and we created a layout that wraps text around an image using floats and clears. Now, we have tons of information about all of these, including design examples of all kinds. So check that out over on Webflow University, but those are the basic CSS positioning options.